afternoon. For those of you that do not know, I'm Gracie Hollett, and this is my brother Patrick Hollett. We gather here today to celebrate the life of our pawpaw, Joseph Henry Murray II. On behalf of our family, we would want to say thank you for being here today, and thank you for being a part of his life. In the chat, there is a link for you to access the program for today's celebration. My pawpaw always loved the number 3. In honor of that, I would like to select 3 words that I use to describe him. Kind, friendly, and fun. I would always remember the fun times I spent with him. I would always teach him my crazy dances, and we would just laugh as I would help him attempt the dance moves. I have one of those recordings on my phone, and it will always now be treasured as a memory I can watch anytime and get a good laugh with my pawpaw.
Thank you, Gracie. As Gracie said, my name is Patrick James Hollett, and I am the grandson of Joseph Murray. One of the last things I got to do with my grandfather was pray. So if you'll bow with me now and grab someone's hand, I'm going to pray. Dear Father, thank you for the wonderful life my grandfather lived and all of the people he truly touched. His message of being happy will be spread to millions. And I pray that you are with me and my family as we may be going through a tough time right now. But by Lord, I know you are with us and you are with all of us. Not just in the death of my grandfather, but through the hard times of everything we're going through right now. So I pray you be with us so we can be happy through this challenging time. Thank you, Lord.
My papa was so lucky because he had 5 sisters. Pat, Nancy, Teresa, Sue, and Mary. He would often tell us stories about all of them. He loved his big family gatherings, especially the Indy 500 parties. His sister Mary was with my pawpaw during some of his hardest days fighting cancer. The last visit I had with my pawpaw, he shared how much that actually meant to him. We cannot think of a better person than Mary to read the poem, God's Garden.
God looked around his garden and found an empty place, then looked down upon the earth and saw Joe's tired face. He put his arms around Joe and lifted him to rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He always takes the best. He knew that Joe was suffering. He knew Joe was in pain. He knew that Joe would never get well on earth again. He saw the road was getting rough and the hills were hard to climb. So he closed Joe's weary eyelids and whispered, "Peace be thine." It broke our hearts to lose you, but you didn't go alone, for part of us went with you the day God called you home.
Hello, my name is William. I'm the chaplain for Hope Hospice, and I would like to thank you all for having me be a part of your father's service as we serve to honor him and his memory and uplift you and your family during this time. And I would like to begin with just a few words from the scriptures. From Matthew 11:27-30. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. In Revelation 21:4-7, he will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and they are true. He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. To those who are victorious will inherit all this. And I will be their God and they will be my children." So what of this great love of God that we know of in these two scriptures? He is the beginning and he is the end. He is all things beyond space and time, undimmed by death, unbound by it, in fact. And he says, come to him, and he will give you rest. The great God of eternity wants to give you rest. In this time of mourning, I know there must be questions and there must be seeking to find peace, but I invite you to please press into the Lord right now, into these difficult times, press into his word. We know this from the book of Luke about him, about his great love, that after his friend Lazarus died, he arrived after he was buried, and he knew what was going to happen. He knew that when he said rise, he would rise up, but he wept. The God of all creation wept. He knows your hurts. He knows what breaks your heart. Lean into him in these times. And when we lean into him, as it says in the 23rd Psalm, as we lean into him, where he leads us to a place where our souls, our lives can be restored and refreshed. But more importantly, it says this: though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. And why is that? I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And that is the great love and the great promise of God, that through this life we may walk through the shadow of the valley of death, but we should not fear, because we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. This is Amazing Grace.
Was lost, but now I'm
My grandfather was truly blessed to have a friend like Jim Mann. Jim Mann flew into most of my grandfather's doctor's appointments and surgeries in the final years of his life. My family thanks Jim Mann. I would like to introduce Jim Mann to deliver my grandfather's eulogy.
Welcome to everyone in attendance. I want to offer my sincere condolences to both Joe's family and friends. I hope at the end of my talk, you will have a better insight into who Joseph Henry Murray II was. Joe was a baby of six and the only boy. Joe's five sisters are Pat, Nancy, Sue, Teresa, and Mary. Joe now also has three children and three grandchildren. His children are Heather, Shannon, and Joey. And his grandchildren are Shannon's two, Patrick, who is 16, Grace, who is 13, and the third is Joey's son, JoJo, who is two. Joe told me many times how much he loved and appreciated his children and grandchildren, especially his grandchildren this last 16 years. He cherished the time he had with them. Joe attended St. Joan of Arc Catholic grade school, where he picked up the nickname Smoky Joe. The story goes like this. As a young teenager, he was experimenting smoking a cigarette sitting in an old sofa in a neighbor's garage. Much later that night, that sofa caught fire. Hence, Smoky Joe. Joe and I met shortly before our freshman year at Cathedral High School in 1966. Cathedral is was an all-boys Catholic school in Indianapolis, Indiana, that was run by the Brothers of the Holy Cross. Ever since that meeting, for 50-plus years, we have remained close friends. Joe was a lot of things to a lot of people. He was a father. He was a grandfather. He was a brother. He was an uncle. He was a friend. He was a lot of things to many people. One of the things that really defines Joe is his friendship skills. He used them to nurture relationships with both friends and family. One of the early outings Joe and I had came shortly after his father's death in December of 1968. This was just a few weeks after the death, so Joe was still working through the sorrow. We got together on Christmas Eve to go shopping for gifts for our mothers. In those days, that meant going to a big department store, not on the internet. While walking around through LS Airs, we came across some distorting body length mirrors. You know, the type like you might find in a carnival funhouse, where it makes your head look the size of a watermelon while making your legs and feet about 6 inches tall. As we stood in front of these mirrors, we began to laugh at our reflections. Before you knew it, that laughter became belly roll laughter, and many shoppers had gathered around us to watch our unbridled happiness. This event began two long-lasting traditions from that time forward. Joe and I went Christmas Eve shopping together every year until the year Joe moved to North Carolina in 1986. It also began a lifelong tradition of having a big belly roll laugh nearly every time we talked or got together. In the last several days, I've been receiving lots of Joe stories from so many of you. I realized Joe used laughter to nurture his friends and family relationships throughout his life. Joe told me many times that he wanted to honor a promise he made his father to be a good provider for his family. Joe had many attributes. He was a great provider, a hard worker, very responsible, fast to teach or help others. He gave advice, Joe was a fun-loving, thrill-seeking, and so many other things. And don't forget Joe's bucket list and goal-setting skills. The attribute I admired the most was his ability to make and keep friends by nurturing the relationships. Joe and I had literally dozens of traditions over the years. They grew from our Christmas Eve shopping and big laughter to several golf outings every year. We every year would wager on the Kentucky Derby and the two other Triple Crown races. Joe would constantly come up with things like that to keep us close, even though we were hundreds of miles apart. From Joe himself and many of you, your stories, I know he had similar ways of staying close to so many of you. Joe truly had a gift of how to nurture relationships with both family and friends. Joe made lasting relationships at every stop in his life's journey. Classmates from school, co-workers at every level and places that he worked, neighbors at every place he had lived, even people he would simply cross paths with, literally nearly anywhere. I can think of an example that expresses this skill. Joe had a friend for the last several years who he met at lunch at a McDonald's back in North Carolina. Joe nurtured this friendship. Joe and his lunch buddy now had been meeting every year somewhere to play golf together for a few days, even though they were miles apart. Joe has continued to nurture his relationship with his sisters. He makes a point to try and visit each of them twice a year, spending time individually with each sister. And for the last several years, they all try to do an annual vacation together. Going back for a moment to a couple of Joe's other attributes, his fun-loving, thrill-seeking, and of course, bucket list and goal-setting. Joe's fun-loving was expressed to me by almost every person, family member, or friend who related a favorite story about Joe. His sisters mentioned the many things he would do or say that would make them actually laugh out loud. Joe's children and grandchildren mentioned how he would make light of himself or his goals or his bucket list, and don't forget his obsession with the number 3 or any number divisible by 3. These things brought smiles to their faces. Joe's thrill-seeking went all the way back to the 1970s. His bucket list was packed with thrill-seeking goals. In the early 80s, Joe wanted to check off the list free fall parachuting. So he enlisted a neighbor friend, to do this with him. A few months later, Joe succeeded and checked that off his bucket list, and at the same time, nurtured his friendship with his neighbor. Another goal Joe created from his bucket list was to run and compete and complete a Boston Marathon. Joe's once again enlisted a friend to train and run the Boston with him. A few months later, Joe completed the Boston Marathon and checked it off his list. The friend did not complete the run, but remained Joe's friend the rest of his life. Many years later, Joe wanted to check off swimming an open water marathon swim. He trained for months, but realized he needed a second person to row a boat alongside his swim. So he enlisted his son, Joey. A few months later, they completed the swim out in Colorado in a huge glacier lake. So Joe checked another item off his list and continued to grow his relationship with his son. I can't tell you how many of Joe's former and current co-workers have shared stories of how Joe's kind words or helpful advice helped to begin a friendship that extended outside work hours. Many of these friendships have lasted for many, many years. With the help of Joe's nurturing, coming up with events, golfing, meetings, or simply long-distance visits. Long after Joe and his co-workers' friends have moved to new places in their lives. In the mid-70s, after Joe graduated college from IUPUI, Joe started his lifelong career in the grocery business. Joe had been working at Kroger during college, so he stayed with Kroger. He moved through several positions at Kroger, in produce, then in operations, and then buying, and finally finished his Kroger career as a store manager in a Mooresville, Indiana store. In 1986, Joe accepted a regional manager position with a fast-growing 500-store chain located in Salisbury, North Carolina, called Food Lion. He moved his family to Gastonia, North Carolina, a suburb of Charlotte. For the next 25 years, Joe climbed the ladder at Food Lion. This required two other moves. Joe spent some time living in Richmond, Virginia. Then he finally moved to the home office in Salisbury, North Carolina. Joe finished his Food Lion career there as the director of training for the entire now 1,000-store chain. Joe semi-retired from Food Lion, but he didn't stay out of the grocery industry very long. Soon Joe was working at Harris Teeter in a produce department. He was very happy there and continued there until now. Joe was working at their store on the Isle of Palm in Charleston, South Carolina. I have received stories from someone at every one of these career and home stops, all the way back to a friend in the 70s that worked at Kroger's with Joe in Indy. All of Joe's children have related how he supported and was proud of their accomplishments in both their career paths and their family lives, including their athletic achievements. Shannon has fond memories of her dad supporting her in running competitions, and she cherishes the mornings they would run together. Joe often mentioned Heather's career successes and her athletic skill in competing in many Ironman-type marathon competitions. And Joey talked about how his dad would often be found on the sidelines by himself, cheering Joe on in his soccer competitions. Joe also loved playing golf with Joey. Joe was truly a relationship nurturer, both family and friends. Finally, and most importantly, I want to thank all Joe's friends and family who helped and stood by Joe in this year-long battle with cancer, especially Joey, who became Joe's primary caregiver. I know Joe is saying now, "Enough, enough, Jimmy, about me. It's time to move on to share a good time and have a big laugh." Cheers to Joe.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. the colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I ever knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Thank you all for coming today. It means a lot to me and my family. My grandfather taught me thousands of lessons. I won't have time to talk about all of them today, but there's two important ones that I want to highlight. The first being be happy, and the second being respect others. These two principles my grandfather taught me define part of the character and man I am today. Be happy. My grandfather always taught me to be happy and enjoy God's small blessings. Because if we can't enjoy the small blessings in life, it's harder to be thankful for the bigger blessings. Secondly, respect others. My grandfather always taught me to respect other people no matter what. No matter their political party, no matter their race, no matter their sexual orientation, and to always love everyone. Because if we don't love anybody, we can't come together in these hard times. And that is one lesson I learned from my grandfather, is despite how hard it may seem right now to get through this together as a country, and despite how divided we are, God still loves us all, and we should still love everyone else. And that is one message that I will carry through the rest of my life. Thank you, Papa.
Father, we give you thanks for the life of Joseph Henry Murray II. Lord, it was your hands that formed him. Before he was even fully created, you saw his unformed substance. And before any of his days began, you had written everyone in your book. And Lord, from the beginning, throughout his life, and even through his death, you have been present to him, ministering to him. Lord, you gave him as a gift to his family, to his friends and his community. And Lord, as you freely gave him to us, so we give him back into your hands. We pray that the power of the death and resurrection of Jesus might be at work on his behalf, to remove all sin and all barrier between you and him, that he might enjoy your presence and your peace and your love for all eternity. Not only for Joe do we pray, Lord, but we pray for his family. We pray that your peace would rest on them. They also would have a sense of your presence, particularly in those lonely places as they learn to live without him for a season. Lord, I thank you for everyone who is gathered for this celebration, and I ask you to bless them as they've been a blessing to this family. We pray this through your Son, Jesus, who enabled us to boldly approach your throne, and even enabled us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. So thank you. On behalf of Joe's family, just thank you for being a part of this celebration. And often we don't know what to say, but just by being present is so, sends such a loud message to the family that they're not alone in this. So I invite you in the comments below to just leave a message. And like I said, you may not have the words to say, so just let the family know that you were here and that you are a part of this celebration, no matter what time you watch this. So, and as we end, I leave you with this ancient blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. Like the Lord has blessed and kept Joseph all of his years. May the Lord's face shine upon you, and may the Lord be gracious to you, pouring out gifts upon you you can neither ask nor imagine. May the Lord lift up his countenance, his smile, and give you peace, a peace that passes understanding, a peace that makes no sense, a peace in the midst of life's storms. May the blessing of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest on us all, now and forever. Amen.